Sensor scan to 1/2 parsec.
On screen.
Weapons are at maximum.
It's more like a big ball of wibbly wobbly, timey wimey stuff.
Open a channel.
All vipers, break, break, break!
Impossible to see the future.
This is the emergency holographic doctor speaking.
You wish the energy talking.
Helmsman laid a new course.
From when? Watch how I saw.
Now, it's gone completely.
Engage.
Hello, and welcome to the Save Sci-Fi podcast. I'm your host, David, and joining me today we have the reanimated corpse of Scarecrow.
Good morning.
Yeah, he's feeling a little bit sick. He's sort of... He's also probably contagious, so if anyone from the CDC is out there, please come and take him off our hands. We don't want to die.
That's me.
We also have Amy.
Heyo.
And we have EJ.
Hi, everybody.
And as we go on, we may or may not gain other people. We don't know. It's sort of one of those open-ended deals. Who knows? So tonight on the podcast, we are talking the ultimate sci-fi war. Basically, over the past 12, 18 months, we've voted on the ultimate hero ship, the ultimate enemy ship, the ultimate hero crew, ultimate enemy crew, the ultimate hero fleet, and the ultimate enemy fleet. So, we've got a lot of talking to do. We've finally finished rounding it all out, so let's sit down and have a discussion and work out who would win, the good guys or the bad guys, if everything went to hell and we went to a full-out scale war.
We'll all be screwed.
Oh, yeah.
I will win.
It'd be bad. Nobility wins by default because everyone else explodes and they're just cruising through going, woo!
I didn't even think about it. I was just being a smartass. I might meet EJ will win. No, only if we're on the side that has the Atlantean drones.
So let's start off with the starbase. So the starbase is effectively the main hub of any campaign. They're left in orbit above the planet to defend the planet, and used to sort of refuel, resupply, all that sort of stuff for the troops on the ground and in orbit and all that fun stuff. So let's see. For the hero fleet, we have Deep Space Nine.
Woo-hoo.
For the enemy fleet, we have the Death Star. Because if you want it done right, do it with overkill, apparently. Defend every planet we own with a planet-destroying laser. Yeah, that... I don't know. I don't. Just sounds like a really bad idea.
Scorched Earth policies.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, it's the Empire for you.
If you can't claim it, blow it up.
Yeah, so... Anyway, let's see... Between those two, which one do we think would be better as a...
Defender? Or destroying?
as a defender. Because the main role is meant to be defense. It's meant to be defensively, primarily.
Sorry, good guys.
Yeah. So it's not like you have, like, DS9 sitting, you know, right next to the Death Star. Cause...
No, they're not trying to slug the crap out of each other. It's effectively all the other ships in the fleet, a random assortment of them, are attacking a planet. And the starbase is there to try and help defend it.
Defend the planet.
Yeah.
Okay, DS9, hands down.
DS9?
DS9.
Yeah? Any particular reason?
Apart from... They're not going to blow up the planet for one.
Even if you're not blowing up the planet, the Death Star, I mean, that laser can be repurposed against ships. Problem is a... It's so vulnerable to large scale attacks. So if you have a few fighters going in, it's so that it's so vulnerable to just one fighter slipping past its defenses and firing a torpedo down its
or a drone
up its tailpipe.
Yeah. Drones work, and you've got puddle jumpers. This cloak park above it, and just go uncloak. Fire drone, cloak, get the fuck out.
Precisely, that's exactly what I was thinking. You get the puddle, I forgot the puddle jumper's cloak. You cloak it, You have it go in close. It just sits there, fires a drone. The drone's self-guided, so you don't really have to do much other than think of destroy this piece of shit, and you're done.
Yeah.
And it's so massive that when it goes, it's probably going to take a good sized chunk of the enemy fleet with it.
Well,
the same argument can be made for the Cylon Raider. Put some high-end nukes on it, which we know that they carry. Fly it up towards Deep Space Nine, jump it through the shields, because the jump drive will allow it to do that, and then launch some nukes at the command center. Or even just any random section of it.
You remember that episode of Star Trek Enterprise where... it was in the first season, and they fire their torpedoes, which function very similarly to the way the nukes work in...
Yeah, and they shoot them down with the phasers.
And the phasers, they just use the phasers as a point defense weapon. So yeah. As soon as they detect the Cylon Raider within its defenses, and they there's no shields, there's no nothing like that, even if the Cylon Raider can survive long enough in order to launch its nukes, which is doubtful to begin with, then you have these slow-moving missiles that can easily be taken out with the phasers that are being used as a point defense weapon.
Yeah, it could just as easily kamikaze it, though. It just jumps into the middle and detonates its wall of nukes. You gotta have a bad day either way.
Yeah.
True, and that's assuming the phasers can't lock on quick enough and they can't destroy it.
Yeah.
It also depends on what model phaser bank they are as well.
Yeah.
If we're talking old school phaser bank, then it's gonna have issues.
Yeah.
But if also, we're talking think about
more
it.
Along the lines of the more recent gen stuff, like on the Enterprise E or whatnot, they've got a setting on that can basically rapid fire like a close in, like a CIWS system that just nuke anything in the airspace.
Yeah.
Bam, 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 bam.
The problem is most of the phasers will be pointed outwards in that scenario. And if you've got multiple raiders jumping in, because you'd have more than one on your army.
That's not how DS9's phasers work. They're not something that you move in position like that. It's this one bar. If you look closely, for example, when they're battling the Klingons or the Jem'Hadar, it's this one little beam there, emitter there that can fire in any direction.
Yeah.
So that argument goes to pot. Also, you have to keep in mind that photon torpedoes and quantum torpedoes, which the station has demonstrated the ability to withstand, packs a lot more punch than a nuke. And it's a lot more concentrated of a punch than a nuke.
Not necessarily. Those weapons we've done sort of calculations on the yield of those weapons. They're not that much more powerful than a nuke. An isoton isn't much more than a megaton. It's just based on the matter antimatter collision, assuming 100% of it is destroyed and there's wibbly wobbly timey wimey stuff involved. But yeah.
Right, but okay, well, so even if they're equivalent, you could hit DS9 sans shields with a nuke, and it could theoretically survive. Plus, even if you take out ops, other portions of the station would be able to take over, and you'd be able to command from other sections.
Yeah, that's definitely a good point. Okay, so Deep Space Nine, out of those two, is the better starbase.
Yes.
Let me just...
I told you that much. Wait, I did.
Okay, we'll rule that one in favor of the good. Okay, next up for scouts. The role of the scout is to check out any to be defenses and report back to base. You right there, Scarecrow?
I'm fine.
Shall I kill you just to put you out of your misery?
I'd appreciate if you didn't.
I was about to say something along that line, but yes.
Okay, anyway,
take care of yourself over there, man.
Yeah, back to the scout. So we got the Puddle Jumper versus the Cylon Raider. Now, for the role of scouting, the Cylon Raider has the ability to FTL jump, whereas only one Puddle Jumper is known to be able to do that. The flip side being this Puddle Jumper could cloak, and Cylon Raiders can't. So,
I would make the argument that the cloaking device is better, even though you have to use a Stargate to get in range.
Yeah.
But once you are in range, you're going to be able to get a lot closer and even do a lot of damage.
Yeah.
As we were talking about with the Death Star, and Puddle Jumper gets in close, and boom.
Yeah. Yeah. Whereas, I still like the, and this is just me, I still like the Battlestar Galactica-style FTL drives. Just as an way of doing FTL, it just seems a lot more practical than a lot of the other drives where you need to be moving linearly. So
it's great to when you're trying to get in range, but once you're in range, you're just another fighter that can easily be shot down by the cap.
Yeah, but the difference is when a Cylon Raider dies, he gets downloaded into another Raider, so you don't even have to bring the thing back. You just, again, being a Cylon, you send it on a one-way mission.
Sure, but that's also resource-intensive way of doing things that eventually...
You'll run out of resources.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Whereas if you conserve your resources and just cloak, if you just cloak, you're covered.
Yeah. I definitely agree that the Puddle Jumper is a better scout, but the Cylon Raider is a better fighter. So.
Oh, what? No, I don't know.
Yeah, but we're hitting. Remember, we're doing it for scouting. Not fighting.
I know. I'm just for balance. So.
you don't have the balance.
Damn it. So.
It's not a fighter. It's a scouter.
The winner for scout is the good guys again. So, now we move on to the fighter, and. YB. We have the Star Fury versus the TIE Interceptor.
I offered to be on your side, man. You told me to be good.
I know.
Come on, had a Deadpool or
EJ, so it's more fun. So to be perfectly honest, I'm just gonna cede this one from the beginning. The TIE Interceptor, while it looks cool, the Star Fury just shits all over it in pretty much every respect.
Okay, so why don't we swap good and evil for this one? You can argue the Starfighter, and I'll argue the TIE Interceptor.
Sounds good.
Shields. TIE Interceptor has shields. Star Fury
does not.
TIE Interceptors don't have shields against lasers. They don't have shields against projectile weapons.
The Star Fury are not projectile weapons.
Are they projectile weapons on the Star Fury?
No, they're not.
The TIE Interceptor doesn't have shields, EJ.
At all?
No, it's not. The only thing it has over the standard TIE fighter is it's faster and has more guns.
Yeah, but I could have sworn that, because I know the X-Wings have shields.
X-Wings have shields. No, they don't put shields on TIEs except for the TIE Advanced, because that's Vader's personal ride, or the TIE Defender.
The TIE Bomber doesn't have shields?
Nope.
I resign. Because the Star Fury has more maneuverability.
Oh, yeah.
The weapons, I would probably say, are about the same. But the Star Fury also has missiles.
Yeah.
So.
And missiles being solid projectiles would pass through the shields in the Star Wars universe anyway. Because Star Wars is yet to... with the exception of the shield that was projected from the surface of the planet around the Death Star, the second Death Star, there's been no demonstration of large-scale solid shielding in the Star Wars universe.
Yes, there has.
That deflects solid objects. The only ones that we've seen are the shields on the hangars and ray shielding and stuff like that. I'm talking in the movie universes, because that's so all that really counts.
In the frickin' movie universes, in movie 3, not movie 3, movie...
6.
The original third.
There are only 3 movies, and they weren't made past 1990.
There is a sequence there where there's a team of X-Wings attacking an Imperial ship, and they have to fire off an entire... essentially their entire load of photon torpedoes... Proton torpedoes. To bring down a quadrant of the shields for the next wave of... for the wave of Y-Wings they're escorting. to get in and do any damage.
Yeah, but those are energy-based weapons.
Also,
they're not also solid weapons.
They're projectile-based. They just have an energy-style warhead. They look red. They're not energy themselves. They can only X-Wing can only carry six of them.
Yeah.
Also,
they are projectile.
Excuse me. Also, keep in mind that remember when the Super Star Destroyer goes down, it goes down because their shields have gone down, which is what enables the A-Wing to get in and kamikaze the bridge.
I don't think it necessarily kamikaze the bridge. I did it sort of shot and just sort of crashed there.
Well,
but
it ends up kamikazing the bridge, which is what and which is what destroys it. Whether or not it was intentional isn't the point. The fact is that they specifically say, our shields are down, concentrate forward firepower. I don't want anything getting through. And then the A-Wing hits it.
Yeah.
Which assumes that the physical body of the A-Wing would not have gotten through if the shields were up. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know...
An argument could be made the other way as well when we saw the Star Destroyer in, I think it was episode 5, where it gets taken out by a, what's it called? Asteroid takes the bridge off the Star Destroyer.
True, but you can also make the assumption that that much mass traveling at that speed is enough to get through the shields.
The question, also, the second question that you have to think about is the asteroid that took the bridge off the Star Destroyer, was that during combat, or were they just cruising around?
At that point, they were trying to chase down the Millennium Falcon, and so it wasn't combat. There was no... Sort of, the only strain that would have, if the shields do stop all solid objects, the only strain that would have been on them would have been from the asteroids in that general vicinity.
Right, but yeah, that
but they've
much
also
got to
deal with the institutionalized stupidity. Imperials.
That's a fair point.
The fact that the captain or admiral or whatever was in charge of that particular rust bucket wouldn't see the Millennium Falcon as a threat, and therefore would not have given the orders to have raised the shields.
Hey, we're talking about a Star Destroyer that managed to crash into each other while chasing the Millennium Falcon. I agree with you on institutionalized stupidity.
But I disagree with you on because, I mean, that is just such a... So, unless you want your entire plot to be based on the boneheadedness of the Imperials, which... doesn't always make sense. And honestly, it's just bad storytelling to begin with if that's what you're doing. Or, again, we come back to what I said earlier of, I'm sorry, you have, I don't care how good your shield generators are, you have that much mass. I'm sorry, if your ship slams into a planetoid, it doesn't matter how good your shields are, the ship's going down.
Agreed.
That is a fair point. But yeah.
But I also think it was more a case that the idiot... Well, it's got shields. He also didn't turn them on because Millennium Falcon wasn't a threat.
That's also a potential. That's also a potentially. But anyway, let's move on to the short sword. We can come back to the shield debate later on when we get to the high end Star Wars ships. Let's see. We got the short sword bomber from Halo versus the Alkesh bomber from Stargate SG-1. Now, the whole point of the bomber is to make runs on the larger capital ships and against the star bases.
SG-1. Evil side this time.
Yeah, I would have to go with evil on this one. The Alkesh bomber's got fairly decent point defense weapons. It can cloak. And while its armament isn't necessarily that good, it still can pack a wallop on its own. Who is mucking about with their microphone?
That's... me rubbing my eyes and making my headset creak.
Okay.
But keep in mind, you also have to keep in mind that the short sword bomber, the pilots of that are used to going up against Covenant. So they're used to dealing with these disadvantages. The Covenant can cloak. The Covenant has shields. The Covenant has energy-based weapons, unlike the short sword bomber. They're used to going up against these kinds of folks and winning on occasion.
Training out doing tech.
Yeah.
So, exactly. So, you can't completely dismiss the short sword bomber.
A lot more maneuverable than the Alkesh as well.
No, the Alkesh is a bit of a tank. But the difference is that...
You have to keep in mind, it's an atmospheric bomber. So,
yeah.
We
it's MOXO.
It does do both, but it does prefer atmosphere. Whereas the Alcash can do both without too much of an issue.
Actually, the short sword was more designed to be, wasn't so much for Atmo, it was more designed for orbital and, or outer atmosphere and then high orbit drops. Yeah.
We also have to keep in mind that the short sword can carry nukes, whereas the Alcash cannot.
Yeah, but the Alcash can also carry troops.
True,
I'd be more worried about a flight of short swords loaded to the gills with frickin'
nukes. Yeah.
And with nukes you don't really need or want troops on the ground. Also, I'm not sure the relative sizes, but if it's designed to carry troops, that's less ordnance it can carry. We also have to keep in mind that it's also going to be bulkier.
Yeah, it uses energy-based weapons, so it doesn't necessarily need space for ordnance, as opposed to the short sword. So it's effectively, mind you, got unlimited ammo. It could just keep bombing and bombing and bombing until it runs out of energy.
We're also looking at it as a bomber, not a dropship, because that's the next one.
I know. The dropship's actually pretty funny when we get to it. So yeah. I think it's the only one that matches up in-universe. So, anyway.
You're right. Those are the only two.
Because they come from the same universe?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So
we can actually very, very easily make a...
So, let's just boil it down to fundamentals. The short sword is more maneuverable, relatively speaking. Can carry nukes. But it has limited ammo, relatively speaking. The Alcash has shields. Cloaking is not as maneuverable. Well, it's the Alcash is pretty maneuverable, it's just not very quick at doing it. Like, you could turn 180 degrees on its own length in space. Whereas, considering how the Halo ships work, so can the short sword, probably. And it's while its weapons aren't as powerful, it can use them for a hell of a lot longer than the short sword can without having to be rearmed. And if you're looking at the Stargate stuff later on in season 10, first episode, on the Gould mothership, they had a spherical bomb, which was effectively a nuke, and that thing, you could fit hundreds of those inside an Alcash. And if you wanted to drop them, you could just use the external ring transporters to ring them outside.
But the rings only work if there's another ring system.
No, the Alcash bomber, just like the Scout Teltac, can actually extend its rings down out of the bottom of the ship.
True, but I thought that only worked if there was a receiving platform.
No, effectively, whatever's inside gets ringed up, and... Whoa, that's a lot of noise. I apologize for those listening. Scarecrow is dying. Soon, hopefully. And then it opens up a little...
Hopefully.
I'm sorry, we know that we love you. Anyway, not
we
the
like
point.
Scarecrow, not really.
Yeah, the bottom of the thing opens up, and the rings come out from the actual ship, and it's the rings from inside the ship that then work outside of the unit. It doesn't need a second platform.
Okay.
So... As far as I know, it only works with an Alcash and a Teltac are the only two which is the Gould scout ship, are the only two that have been shown to be able to do that. So, and random note about rings, did you know on some of the crates in Stargate Atlantis in the Daedalus class, and I think they were in Prometheus as well, some of the crates said do not ring transport? What is the point of having the rings if you can't ring transport things?
Oh, but think about it. If it's something that's volatile, like a nuke, perhaps a matter energy conversion is not the best thing to use.
Yeah, but they beam stuff on and off those ships all the time, including nukes.
Yeah, it doesn't mean it's a good idea. And every time they've done it, there's been an extreme need to do so. Either if you're going up against a race ship and get past the shields. You alright over there, Scarecrow?
I'll get back to you on that.
Wow.
Take care of yourself, man.
That's why I said stay home and rest and get better.
Yeah. Scarecrow, if you need to go to sort of, lack of a better word, die,
Go die.
You can, as long as you get back to us and let us know that you're not dead.
I'll talk to him in a couple hours anyway. So, go and crash.
Yeah, dude, go and crash. It's,
for a while now. The cough has started.
Hi.
See you guys.
Sorry.
It's all good.
Thanks for joining us.
See you guys.
See ya. Alright, so that's Scarecrow going. Okay, anyway. Where were we? Short sword. Short sword versus Alkesh.
How a short sword's better than the bomber.
the Alkesh. Well, see, the difference is we know the Alkesh's shields can stop solid projectiles. So even if the short sword wanted to say there was a short sword around trying to stop an Alkesh from coming in, the Alkesh has shields. It's got better defenses than the short sword does.
But, okay, but then...
The
short sword wouldn't be going up against an Alkesh. It'd be a Star Fury or a Puddle Jumper going up.
Yeah.
The
Star Fury would... the weapons probably wouldn't do that much against the Alkesh, but the Puddle Jumper could definitely take it out with the drones.
Exactly.
But the same could be said for the short sword, though. The Cylon Raider and the TIE Fighter could both take out a short sword bomber.
Right, but it would be an even playing field.
Yeah. So.
So I mean the Raider and the TIE Fighter would technologically speaking be about at the same level as the short sword, or the only advantage the TIE Fighter would have is its energy based weapons.
Yeah.
And which is something that a short sword bomber is used to dealing with. So you're not really having too many advantages there. If you want to compare the Alkesh and the short sword toe to toe, it'd be whether or not they're capable of reaching their objective, and once they do, are they going to be able to hit the
target?
Hit the target, and with what size payload and what accuracy?
Yeah, well, that was actually just about what I was going to shift to. I was going to say the target for the Alkesh is the high end of the hero ships. So you're looking Galaxy class from Star Trek, Mercury class from Battlestar Galactica, or Aurora class from Stargate Atlantis. So in all cases, it's a shielded ship going up against a shielded ship, with the exception of the Mercury, which has got probably some of the most brutal point defense weapons we've seen in sci-fi for a projectile weapons based ship.
In an addition to that, it's also demonstrated that without shields, it can handle a nuke. So.
Oh yeah, without shields, it can handle quite a lot. And the Aurora class and the Galaxy class would probably rinse an Alkesh without too much effort.
Mm-hmm.
And whereas the other way is the short sword going up against, and this is why I hate being the bad guys. This is just not fair. It's the short sword bomber going up against an Imperial class Star Destroyer, or Imperial II class Star Destroyer, I should say, the Wraith Hive and Executor, the Super Star Destroyer. And against the Imperial ships, I would probably say that, well, definitely against the Wraith Hive, because Wraith Hive has not shown much in the way of anti-fighter point defense systems.
They rely heavily on their shields, but their shields can go up against nukes.
Wraith don't have shields. Wraith rely on their hull. They don't have shields in any way, shape, or form.
I could have sworn the Wraith had shields, and that's why they couldn't beam the...
They release they have a weird sort of scrambling energy field that the Hive emits that stops them from getting a proper lock on the destination, but they don't actually have shields. Like,
they don't have physical shields.
Yeah, they don't have physical shielding.
The shields in Star Wars are so weak. Yeah, the short sword, I mean, especially with the Star Destroyers, you just fly in close and drop your payload inside the bomber bay or the hangar bay, and boom, bye bye kitty.
Yeah, well, but I thought you said that you couldn't fly through the shields on a Star Destroyer a minute ago.
So you use one nuke to take out the shields, you use the next nuke to get in close.
You've got to get close.
You got one nuke on those things.
So, all right, well, see, me, I think based on what it has to do, and considering the Alkesh has to take on a Galaxy class and an Aurora class, it's going to get rinsed. So compared to what the Short Sword will get messed up, but at least it sort of stands a chance against the Wraith Hive and to some extent the Star Destroyers. So I would have to go with the good guys winning again. Look at that.
Especially if you have a Galaxy class, Mercury class, and Aurora.
Yeah, you're going to have a bad day.
Okay, so we've got four for good guys and one for bad.
No, none for bad. We haven't. Bad hasn't won anything yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. I thought I was going to lose the bomber. I really did.
Yeah. Well, you by rights, the Alkesh is a better bomber than the Short Sword, but once you look at the targets... Once you look at what they're going up against, yeah, it's not fair. It's not fair at all.
I told you this last night. The bad guy ships are designed to lose against the good guy ships.
Yeah. I'll win one eventually. So moving on to the dropship.
The best shot at winning one was the Death Star, and that didn't go very well. So bye-bye.
So okay. Next up is the dropship. We have a totally in-universe battle here. We have the Pelican from Halo versus the Phantom from Halo. And the purpose of these ships is to get the troops from the larger ships down to the surface, one way or another. And defend that point, or board enemy ships and defend that point when that option is available. So, to be perfectly honest, I think the Phantom has this one, relatively speaking. It can carry heavier items mounted underneath it. The Wraith Hive is heavier than a Scorpion tank. It can hold more troops than a Pelican can. It's got multiple point defense turrets that are energy-based weapons, so you don't have to worry about ammo scattered around it with the front and on the sides. The problem with the side ones is you've really got to sort of open it up to crack her open to use them, so there's that. That's a downside. But yeah, other than that, I think it's also got substantial... Well, I don't actually know about the armor on it.
Well, it's got shielding.
Does it have shields?
It looks like a balloon. Got a balloon top.
Yeah. I don't know if the Phantom has shields.
It does.
Yeah, okay. Well, we'll go with EJ saying it does then.
I've destroyed a number of them in Halo.
Yeah, so have I. I just can't remember if it hits the ship directly or if it has shields. Anyway.
Everything the Covenant has, except for the grunts, have shields, pretty much.
Yeah, fair point. And you get the Pelican, which has got a nose-mounted machine gun and a rear-mounted machine gun if you open it up, and some missiles, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. But you also have to keep in mind that it's smaller, more maneuverable, faster.
Yeah.
And so it's a completely different strategy. The dropship, the Phantom goes with more of the tank mentality,
and
whereas the Pelican does more of what a dropship should do, which is move in there, have a light defenses just so you can't, so you can provide some cover for the troops as they get out, maybe take out one or two medium-sized targets like a ground-based turret or something, drop the ships, get the equipment out of there, and bug out. That's what a dropship's supposed to do, and that's what it does perfectly. The Phantom dropship, because it is so heavily armored or whatnot, does kind of sit... It has a tendency to linger as a support vessel.
Yeah.
Which also increases the likelihood of it getting taken out. And especially if you read the Halo novels, which I believe are canon, the Halo military, the
Covenant,
UNSC, normally wins on the ground. The only reason that the UNSC is losing is because they
ship to ship, they don't stand a chance.
They'll compete ship to ship, unless the numbers are 3-1, which we can't keep up indefinitely. We being humanity.
Yeah.
And so it depends on what you're looking at. It. Yes, it's tougher. Yes, it can provide support, but as a dropship, going back and forth and just go in, drop them off, bug out, get another load, come back, drop them off, bug out, and making multiple runs and getting as many troops as possible on the ground
The good guys win again.
Possible, the drop ship, the Pelican's going to win.
But you're forgetting one key point the Pelican has that the the Phantom has that the Pelican doesn't. The Phantom is FTL capable. It can just FTL to near the surface, drop its troops and FTL away. They're seen doing that in Reach on multiple occasions in the Reach games. And especially in the battle in orbit, you see them FTLing near the space station. Yes, they do linger around a bit. But being able to close that distance, a short sword's got to fly... a Pelican's got to fly down, land, and then fly back up. In that time, a Phantom could have FTL'd twice and done two runs.
So it's catch 22.
Yeah, sort of. It's a...
So, evil guys win this round? Or is it a tie?
Well, I'm not seeding this one. I'm definitely sticking by the Phantom on this one.
I think it's more a tie.
Yeah. Amy, the Little Miss Diplomat.
Again, it's very different strategies and depends on what your tactics are. The Phantom is much more of a support ship. Yes, it has that FTL ability, but how often is it seen using it? You only see it in Reach, to my knowledge.
Yeah.
And it's more of, it sits there, plus...
They don't really like FTLing in atmosphere, to be perfectly honest.
Well, it depends on how the FTL for...
Yeah, but we're looking at it as a dropship.
Yeah.
But also, we're looking at it as a dropship.
Yeah.
Really simple dropship.
Yeah. And the like I said, the Phantom's got the capability of bringing in more heavier units than the Pelican. So even if you bring in fewer troops, if you can bring in heavier units, then...
It's a tie.
Yeah.
But it doesn't matter. It's Zerg versus Protoss. For those StarCraft fans out there, you can build more Pelicans, you can build them quicker, you can get more of them into the battle, and they're going to have quicker payloads, roundabouts, than the Pelicans. So while, yes, you're bringing in heavier troops, and yes, they're harder to destroy, they linger, so there's more opportunity to destroy them, and... it just depends on what kind of strategy you employ. If you employ a strategy of more of a swarm strategy, then you're going to very easily overwhelm the Covenant forces that it's dropping off. Or you just have Master Chief there to say, fuck you all.
Yeah, I was just going to say, the only reason that the UNSC were winning the ground battles wasn't that they were throwing more troops at them, it was because of the Spartans. One Spartan's like a Jedi.
But the Spartans, there was such a small number of Spartans, they couldn't be anywhere, everywhere, and these were grand patterns they were seeing throughout the entire campaign. So while, yes, especially in the major battles, the Spartans were a big deal, the overall campaign was not completely reliant on the Spartans, especially when you're talking about an interstellar campaign, and eventually you only
you've only got a couple of dozen Spartans, yeah.
Yeah,
or
actually,
eventually.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm willing to call it a tie. I'm willing to go that far.
I will keep arguing until I win, so I'll let you guys call it a tie. No, actually, I thought you guys had me on that one, so I just argued the shit out of it. Is all.
So quick, just hold the line. Hold the line.
We'll just leave it as a tie.
Shut up. Give you a tie, okay?
No, just before the reason I say a tie is because they've both got their ups and downs, but they pretty much even themselves out.
Yeah. Okay. This one, I think, is a fairly easy win to me. I say that because it's a Carillion Corvette, the CR-90, versus an original series version of the Romulan Bird of Prey. And... the whole point of a Corvette mostly is sort of to a point troop transport in space, but for the most part it is mopping up fighters and bombers. And Romulans are outfitted with disruptors, and compared to the lasers on the Star Wars ships, it's not necessarily a fair fight.
I'm not sure about that one, because the main The Romulan Bird of Prey is not built for anti-fighter support. The Romulan Bird of Prey is built for sneak attacks on outposts.
Yeah. It cloaks, it appears behind you, it destroys your CR-90, it cloaks and disappears.
True.
At which point you're not mopping up my fighters, my fighters are mopping up yours.
True,
so.
but that's not the role that a corvette would play in a major military battle.
Yeah.
And that's not the role that the Bird of Prey would be asking. Yes, if those two went directly head-to-head, you are 100% right. That said, they would not be going head-to-head in a major battle, just like the short sword would not be going directly up against the Alkesh.
Yeah, it's a case of looking at what the role is.
In which case, a TOS corvette going up against a Galaxy class, or the Aurora, or even the Puddle Jumper?
Oh yeah, the TOS Romulan class going up against capital ships, that's not something it would do. It would cloak and it would get the fuck out. It would really not hang around.
If
it's going up against Star Furies and Short Sword Bombers, it would more than likely, because of the way the disruptors work, rinse them.
The disruptors, again, it's primary weapon is meant to be used against large stationary targets. So having it play the role of a corvette in this one doesn't quite work. And keep in mind that the Puddle Jumper would be able to sneak up on it and kill it anyway.
Yeah.
Whereas you couldn't do that. A Cylon Raider going up against a corvette, with the blasters it has or the lasers.
Well, it's only got the Corvette's only got, I think it's only got one, maybe two laser banks, one on the top and one on the bottom.
I didn't say it was a good Corvette.
Actually, no. Sorry, I'm wrong. It's got four lasers, two on the top and two on the bottom, and right. they're all anti-asteroid lasers. So
honestly, I'd much rather have a Mercury class as a Corvette in this instance because of its point defense weaponry. But
the other role of the Corvette is to go into areas that the larger ships can't. So it's to that's why they were so, I made them so small, was so that in the old military back in the day, the Corvettes used to be loved by pirates because they could disappear up a river and they were so shallow. At the waterline, that they could go so much further up those rivers than the frigates could, and the frigates couldn't follow them. And the only choice the frigate had was to sit there and wait for them to come back, which they never did. They just stay up the river for weeks and wait for the frigate to give up.
Okay.
So if you're talking about hit and run attacks, then yes, the Romulan Bird of Prey would win. But if you're talking about using it as an anti-fighter weapon, then I would go with the Corvette.
Yeah.
Or, I'm sorry, the CR-90.
Yeah.
Okay, so have we decided which one wins this round, or is it another tie?
I think this one's a tie, personally.
Yeah, the depending on what role it is taking on any given day, I think it would be the Corvette would be better as an anti-fighter type role, except against an Alkesh, because of the way the shielding works in Stargate, and the Romulan would be better at the getting in, hitting, and getting the fuck out.
Okay. Speeding is up for the fact is it's like 40 past.
I know, we're running out of time, but...
And we haven't even got to anything else but the ships.
Yeah.
And not first row.
Just getting there. Okay, the next one is an interesting one, because we don't know that much about one of the ships. We've got, on one side, we've got the Intrepid class, a.k.a. Voyager. On the other hand, we have the Asuran Frigate. Also known as the Asuran Corvette, or half a dozen other names. It's effectively the entry-level Inlantian tech ships. Bigger than a Puddle Jumper, but smaller than the Aurora class. We know that it fires energy-based weapons, because we see it in combat against the Apollo. We know it can cloak. And we know it fires drones, but that is about it. We don't actually know that much more about it.
The drones are ridiculously overpowered. However, they take long enough to go from one ship to another that even if you look at the Intrepid class, you have a very TNG galaxy-style elongated phaser transmitter or phaser emitter on both the top and bottom and in the rear, along the pylons towards for each of itself. And because of that, the drones, I would argue that a phaser's point defense capability is much faster and would be able to target the drones and knock them out immediately, which would be the Intrepid's, or which would be the Asuran frigate's, most deadly weapon, the energy-based weapon, where you're going up against shields that are meant to take out phasers and other energy-based weaponry. And I've seen nothing in the Stargate universe that would show that their weaponry is more powerful than TNG's weaponry.
At very least, they're on par.
At the very least. But you can't argue one's better than the other because there's no indication that
one way or the other.
One way or the other. You never see them go head-to-head, obviously, because of different universes. And the way that they're used is very similar to Star Trek. So there's that.
Stargate, are you trying to imply that the people at Stargate ripped off Star Trek?
What do you mean imply? I'll say it.
And I won't disagree.
Yeah, but to be fair, Nobility borrows some from Star Trek as well, so.
Yeah. So, blatantly. See, if I was in the Asuran frigate and I was trying to take out an Intrepid class, I would approach cloaked. And I would decloak right on top of it and just unload as many drones as I could as quickly as I could, because they do swarm. And even if you could take out a few of them, you probably won't take them all out. And all you need is one to get through and hit the warp core. And that's game.
True, but that's first off, that's assuming that they'd be able to get past the shields and...
The drones are shown to pass through every form of shielding in Stargate.
True that.
So,
Also, the holes in the structural integrity fields, you can make an argument, are stronger on in Star Trek. But beyond that, you're assuming that the type of cloaking that they're using is something that the scanners wouldn't be able to see, for one. For two, you're also having to argue with the fact that, if I can remember my point, I can continue making it. what was it? And that the crew on the ship wouldn't be able to react fast enough to stop it. Assuming there's a declared state of war and they know that it's an enemy vessel.
Yeah.
You're assuming that A, they wouldn't see it, and even if you did decloak point blank, that they wouldn't be ready for it, or in a battle scenario already have their shields up and as soon as just like when there's an episode of DS9 when the Federation was at war with the Klingons. And it was the trial episode where Worf was captaining the Defiant, and a Klingon ship was decloaking right in front of the Defiant, and he said, like, detected it starting to decloak and immediately fired before it even finished decloaking. No. So if you're in a battle scenario and an Intrepid class detects an Asuran frigate decloaking, it's going to immediately open fire and, bye.
Yeah.
And that's assuming that the shields, if the shields can be raised,
on the Asuran ship
while it's cloaked in the Stargate universe, that doesn't mean that the payload that the Intrepid could
the same cloak shield thing applies in Stargate as Star Trek.
Yeah, no ripping off there. In which case.
It's that the only reason it's the same is because otherwise it's too powerful.
Yeah, I completely agree. So as soon as it decloaks to use its weapons, before it even finishes decloaking, it's bye-bye birdie. So
yeah.
So evil size wins? Bad side wins?
Yeah, okay, I'll see this one. We don't know enough about the Asuran frigate to make a good argument about its capabilities. Mm-hmm. Now, this one, to be honest, I don't know that much about the destroyer that's on my team. The Vorcha, yeah. The Daedalus class I know quite a lot about, but the...
Yeah, the Vorcha, it's a standard Klingon destroyer. it's one of the workhorses of the Klingon Empire, and it's probably on par with probably a Miranda class.
Yep.
Or I'd say the way it's used, a Miranda class or an Akira class.
Yep. Well, you, sir, get the 304 Mark II, which is the Daedalus class ship with Asgard beam upgrades, as your destroyer. The main role of the destroyer is to take out the smaller ships and try and take out, or at least pin down, the larger ships.
Tag, good team.
What?
Tag, yeah. Good side.
Yeah, it's just like, hey, I'm willing to see this one pretty much from the beginning. A Daedalus class with Asgard beam weapons. There's not much that could go up against that and walk away at the end of combat.
The Vorcha. Okay, I'll play evil for now. The Vorcha. So you don't have the same kind of sensors that you have. The reverse problem, the reverse argument of what I made with the Intrepid. The destroyer, the 304 Mark II, doesn't have the sensor capability to detect cloaked ships or to be able to react fast enough once they cloak.
Actually, they do. In the episode where the Asuran frigate went up against the Apollo,
right?
When the Asuran ship decloaked, the Apollo was all over it almost immediately.
Okay, but with railguns.
Yeah. Railguns and missiles, because it didn't have the Asgard beam upgrade at that point.
True, but the Vorcha moves in too close for the Asgard beams to do anything, launches a spread of photon torpedoes, and bye-bye. And the railguns, and I mean, the Mark II still has railguns, and you know, those would be the only ones that would really be able to attack that close. And yeah. At that closer range, and those aren't going to do shit against the Vorcha's shields.
Yeah, but it wouldn't take long for the Vorcha, if it decloaked that close. Don't forget that the Daedalus class do carry nukes, including the Mark 9 tactical warhead, which is effectively the strongest weapon in Stargate Shy, blowing up a sun, which is cheating.
Wait. It didn't blow up a sun.
No. That Carter blew up a sun.
Yeah,
With a Stargate. Yeah, like I said, the Mark 9 is the strongest weapon in the series, with the exception of blowing up a sun. You're turning a sun into a weapon. That's just not fair. That's cheating.
We've already established when we were talking about DS9 and the Cylon Raiders is Star Trek ships would be able to withstand a nuke because a photon torpedo and a quantum torpedo is roughly as powerful as a really advanced nuke.
Yeah, the difference is an Aquadri enhanced nuke is exponentially more powerful again. That's because we were doing yield calculations for the Prometheus versus NX-01. And one of the things that became very clear very quickly was that the Stargate-era nukes, especially the Nequadri-enhanced nukes, are so stupendously overpowered that it's not even funny.
But even if it was carrying those nukes, would it use it when the Vorcha is right there? You would destroy yourselves as well.
That's a fair point.
So, yeah. I mean... Plus,
but again, we go back to the Intrepid argument, where if they're at a state of war, they'd be on high alert at all times. And
you wouldn't detect the Vorcha until it was too close to use nukes or beam weapons.
Yeah. So, yeah.
So even if it was on high alert at all times, it wouldn't matter because of the fact that you wouldn't be able to detect it until you get in close.
Yeah.
So evil side wins.
Well, yeah, we'll give this one to evil. I still think the Daedalus would the role of destroying things would rinse, the Daedalus would rinse pretty much anything on your side of the field. It is actually rinsed. The next one and the carrier. It's on a fairly regular basis for these upgrades.
Not necessarily, because the Mercury class...
Not Mercury class. I'm talking your side of the field.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Me being good at the moment and you being evil is at the moment.
Sorry.
Because the Daedalus class with Asgard Beam has taken down Ori Motherships and has taken down Wraith Hives. So.
Yeah, that one I agree with you on.
Yeah. Okay. So Michael has joined us in our tiny little interim. You guys won't notice it because I'll just splice the two chunks together. He will be taking over my role in the discussion because I suck, obviously, and I've lost pretty much everything. For that, I blame Amy.
How?
And I blame Scarecrow because... Just because I can. No,
doesn't work that way.
God damn it, I'm going to lose again, aren't I?
Yes.
So... Anyway, so EJ's still here, and we have been joined by Michael, one of the other admins, as we continue our taunt through the list of the ultimate sci-fi fleet. So next up, we have the Akira class from Star Trek versus the Ori Mothership from Stargate. You could be on whatever the hell side you want to be on.
Well, because thus far I've been on the good side. Except for when David doesn't know what the hell he's talking about, and then I switch sides. So,
yeah.
Well, I'm taking over for David, so I think that, I mean, especially for this
EJ could stay. EJ could stay good. Michael can go bad, and I'm just gonna sort of sit in the middle and laugh.
I'm going bad. I'm going bad, guys.
Go dark side. So the role of
the podcast to Aussies, you've gone bad.
Yeah. So anyway, So the role of the range ship in the fleet is to attack other targets from outside of their effective targeting range. So whether that be doing surface bombardment or attacking enemy ships from a range at which they can't practically respond. The Ori Mothership's main gun, the yellow laser of death, is not only stupendously powerful, it has a fairly ridiculous range on it. And the Akira class has a stupid amount of photon torpedo launchers, so that's why it won that role. So, in all our combat, in those roles, which one do we think would be better?
Star Trek equals Akira equals win.
Okay, clearly the Ori Mothership is going to wipe the Akira off the face of the Earth. Not just face of the Earth, out of space. Out of existence.
Orbit. The word Michael is looking for is orbit.
Orbit. That would be the word I am looking for. Thank you very much, David.
Are they going toe-to-toe against each other, or are they going up against other vessels and either damaging their shields if it's a capital ship, or is it or taking out a target from outer space? Now, if you're talking about taking a target from outer space, there's no evidence that the Ori ship can compete with a Starfleet starship, because the Akira class, just like pretty much all Starfleet ships, are capable of destroying entire planets. Which is something they've established since the original series.
Wait a second. Since when have starships been regularly able to destroy planets?
It's been established since the original series that a starship can destroy a planet. Now, render it lifeless.
Well, that anything can do that.
Okay.
Any kind of bombardment. You can have asteroids go bombard the surface and make it lifeless. There's no reason to say that an Akira class is any more effective than an Ori mothership.
And the Ori mothership we have actually seen bombard the surface of a planet and has effectively glassed the immediate area.
Exactly.
The immediate area, yes, but would it be? It would have to take out the entire planet. It would have to sit there and for months just be bombarding area after area after area. Whereas
Remember. Do you remember the episode of Stargate Atlantis? What I'm talking about. SG-1. Where they had to phase the planet out of existence in order to escape the Ori weapons.
Yeah.
Yes, that doesn't mean that the planet as a whole and the entire biosphere was in danger, that just means they didn't want their cities, our cities, taken out. But there's
no
taking out our cities and wiping out the entire face of the planet. And it took three Ori ships to just to force them to do that, whereas an Akira class could easily, just like the Defiant did in Deep Space Nine, fire a payload of torpedoes that has a toxic a reaction in the atmosphere and render the entire planet lifeless, or could also drill, use the phasers to drill different areas as seen in TNG and release noxious gases that would, in effect, render the planet lifeless.
Yeah, sadly, Michael, I actually have to agree with EJ a little bit on this one. The Ori mothership, while the reason they cloaked the whole planet was to protect the cities from orbital bombardment, not to protect the actual physical planet and biosphere. Outside of that, if you also look at the secondary role, which is to attack larger ships from a sort of an uncounterable distance, I think
guidance system on the photon torpedoes would be you'd be able to program the torpedoes and fire it from a much further range than a, and from a different angle. Like, you could fire it from like the other side of a torpedo of an asteroid. The torpedo would circle around the asteroid and hit the target, whereas the Ori ship can only go in a straight line.
Yeah, but the Ori ship would go through the asteroid. It would just be like, asteroid, what asteroid? Boom.
Yeah.
By the way, there's an Ori mother. There's an Ori mothership here right now. What are you going to do about that?
As far as in space, EJ, that weapon, the Ori weapon, is 10 times or more stronger than a single photon torpedo. It would take a ton of photon torpedoes to do anywhere near the damage of an Ori, of the Ori weapon.
The Akira class has a ton of photon torpedo launchers.
That is true, but the weapons will run out. The Ori ship, with the strength of its shields, the Ori ship can withstand easily that kind of bombardment of any sort.
Okay,
considering the
that Stargate shields are more powerful than Star Trek shields.
Yes, but just like in Star Trek, the Stargate shields scale with technology. They've explicitly stated that the closer to white a shield is in Stargate, the stronger it is. So the yellow shields on the Gould Hartax are substantially weaker than the blue shields on the Asgards, which are substantially weaker than the white shields on the Ori mothership, which is why Ori mothership, four of them, managed to take on over a dozen Hartax, an Asgard mothership, and multiple 304s.
Mm-hmm.
And walked away without a scratch.
But again, so now it comes down to tactics, and it comes back to what I was saying. Yes, the Ori ship is more of a juggernaut. It can punch through the asteroid and boom, hello, Ori mothership. Whereas the Akira could hide behind an asteroid, could hide behind a, hide in the magnetic field of a planet or whatnot, and attack indirectly. Doesn't matter. And if it fires a shit ton of photon torpedoes from the other side of an asteroid, yeah, the Ori ship could destroy the asteroid, but the Akira class has already fired his payload, is long gone.
Yeah,
comes down to strategy.
The problem is, yeah, I know, but the thing is, those torpedoes are just so much weaker than this weapon in general. They may be more maneuverable and more efficient in hitting more accurate. However, the weapon of the Ori weapon is just downright so powerful that it will overpower any kind of shields.
Okay, let's look at the potential targets for the Akira. The Akira's primary target would be the Starbase, which is the Death Star, and the destroyer up on the enemy side. So the Vorcha, Ori Mothership, Imperial II Class Star Destroyer, Wraith Hive, and Executor Star Destroyer. Whoops, I forgot to turn that onto silent. My bad. Apologies for the random Skype noise.
The
Ori Mothership on the other hand, has to take on the Deep Space Nine, the Akira, the Daedalus Mark II, which we know can take out Ori Motherships. The Akira, the Galaxy class, the Mercury class, and the Aurora class. Now, looking at it from their potential targets, I really hate to say it, but the Akira against a Star Destroyer, it's not that necessarily that fair on the Star Destroyer, to be honest.
Well, the Star Destroyer does have shields.
Yeah, but they're very weak shields compared to Star Destroyer.
Agreed. And also the Wraith with the the Wraith Hive doesn't have shields. The Death Star.
And a couple of nukes would take out a Wraith Hive, so photon torpedoes would just shred it.
Yeah, no, I would have to agree based on the targets that the Akira has a much better chance of winning.
So yes, there's a slight advantage to the Ori ship if it's going directly up against the Akira class, but in every other circumstance that a range ship would be asked to function, the Akira class is going to win.
Yeah, unless it's an incredibly prolonged battle. In a prolonged battle, the Ori mothership would probably become more useful than the Akira, because the Akira would just run out of ammunition.
Exactly.
Because you do have the phasers, so it wouldn't become completely useless.
It wouldn't become completely useless, but it's
that's
not...
the strength of the Akira, that it has so many torpedoes.
Yeah.
And who's to say that they couldn't fit an industrial-strength replicator on it, or industrial-scale replicator on the Akira class, and start replicating...
because there's no evidence that they can replicate antimatter.
True. Well, I don't know about antimatter directly, but then you just siphon it off from the warp engines, which in a battle you're not going to want the warp necessarily need the warp engines anyway, except for a small amount of antimatter in order to get the hell out, to bug out if things go bad. So if you use most of your antimatter and replicate the rest of the parts. And then just insert the antimatter. Yes, your rate of fire will be greatly slowed, but you could do that. And I had another point, but I can't remember.
So is this a tie again?
No.
Hang on. I have one more thing about this. The Ori, the Ori ship, does it or does it not have its fighters?
The Ori
fighters.
Yeah, the Ori ship itself would technically have the fighters that it has. One of the rules was if a ship comes armed with something, it gets that as part of combat.
Okay,
but
well, then
fighters.
In that case...
let me finish.
Okay.
The Ori fighters, though, against us, it's very well established that fighters in the Star Trek universe are effectively pointless.
Agreed.
Because the Star Trek universe ships with the phasers are so devastating at taking out smaller objects that the fighters are effectively pointless. I don't see a reason for the Ori under these circumstances to launch their fighters if they're going up against something like that.
And
well,
even
those
if
fighters
they
could wreck an Akira class. I mean, not necessarily wreck, but it could seriously cause some problems having to deal with them at the same time.
Not really.
You have one weapons team working the torpedoes, or you have a pre-programmed thing going on with the torpedoes. And then anything that that gets in range of the phasers are such a powerful point defense weapon.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, it would just be bam, 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 bye, bye, fighters.
Yeah.
Well,
I have to agree with AJ on that one.
If it worked that way in Star Trek Online, I'd be a lot better off.
Well, we're not talking about for the most part games and stuff. We're talking about what's shown on screen in the TV shows. So
I know.
So. And while the Ori fighters are stupendously powerful, compared to phasers, there's not really that much of a defense. So
okay.
Yeah. So sadly, that one goes to EJ as well. Come on, Michael. Michael, pick a game up.
Hey, then you have to stand with me, man.
Hey, I'm trying to play Switzerland. And be on the winning side at the end of it with lots of money.
Oh, wait, I did not realize there was money involved here.
There's
none.
there's a whole lot of nothing.
You won't see any, so you don't need to be aware.
Exactly.
Ooh.
Okay.
Okay, moving on to the cruisers, and
this one just ain't fair, guys. I win.
Yeah, I'd have it's a Galaxy class versus a Star Destroyer.
You hit one photon torpedo to take out the shields, another to take out the bridge. Bye bye.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Easily.
Yeah.
And considering that the Galaxy class can launch something like 5 or 6 torpedoes in a spread, no, you're out. You're gone. Bye.
Yeah. Okay. This one I think is probably going to be the most...
Did I miss the frigates?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dang, that would have been a fun one to fight EJ on. That would have been easy.
We tied it. I tied that one.
What? Yeah. What? No, we have to... Oh, my God.
So, you want to... Okay, do we want to re... So, the frigate, which is the Asuran Corvette and Voyager, correct?
Yeah.
No, and the Bird of Prey, Romulan Bird of Prey.
No, EJ, you're thinking of the wrong one.
Oh, I'm thinking of... no, I won that one, I think.
Yeah, you won that one because I said we didn't know enough about the ships to the Asuran ship to make a fair sort of defense.
Oh, that is a replicator ship. That ship is easily one of the strongest ones.
It's the Corvette class. You only see it twice in the whole show.
Fair enough, but it also has drones, and drones are incredibly accurate. They are fast. They are powerful, and they can break through shields.
Of course.
But they're still relatively slow, and the Voyagers...
And they're also solid objects, and the Voyager phasers could potentially take them out if they're remotely close to within targetable range.
Even if... exactly.
How many bays... I believe... correct me if I'm wrong. I believe the Intrepid class only has 2 phaser bays. They would not be able to handle defending against all of the drones at once.
A swarm of drones, yes, but the Asuran Corvette can't fire a swarm of drones. It's really? Only ever shown firing half a dozen or so at a time.
And when you take into account the fact that, no, it is not 2 phaser banks, not bays, you have the top phaser array, you have a bottom phaser array, and then you have phaser banks on the pylons and the nacelles. Now, keep in mind that, yes, there is 2 on the top, 1 on the bottom, and 1 on each thing. They can target multiple things and rapid fire, as you see multiple times in TNG with the Galaxy class. So what you would have is there's these half a dozen drones coming in. You would see this bam, 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 bam of quick succession phaser bursts. Yeah. That would take it out.
The Battle of Asuris, when the mothership, what's it called? The one of the enemy Auroras is coming at them. They actually shot down the drones with other drones in flight. So, and that was explained in the audio commentary what that was. And that was when Shepard drones. And yeah. So the drones can be taken down in flight.
By point defense. Okay. So. And phasers are going to travel a lot faster than the drones. So you lose that. The only thing that the Asuran frigate has on the Intrepid class is the fact that it can cloak. Now, when you take into account the fact that you're in a battle scenario, the weapons and shields are down while it's cloaked. Even if it got in close and decloaked, the ship, just like the Defiant in DS9, as soon as the Intrepid detects that ship's decloaking, it's going to open fire before it can get its shields up.
Mm. I don't like letting EJ win.
What?
I don't like letting EJ win. I don't like this. I'm used to beating him in StarCraft.
I offered to be evil, and I knew exactly how I would plan the battle if I was evil, but I won't tell you until we're done with the debate, and I've already won.
Yeah.
Crap.
Okay, so skipping the cruiser because it's effectively a no contest.
Yes.
This is the one I've been waiting for.
Oh.
The Mercury class Battlestar versus a Wraith Hive. The Wraith Hive gets its darts. So the Wraith Hive has upwards of 1,000 darts that it can launch at any point in time. The Mercury class Battlestar can only launch a couple of dozen. I think it's only fighters at any point in time. I think it's upwards about 40 or 50, something like that.
You have 2 wings, I believe, and you're talking about 40.
Yeah, give or take, compared to the better part of 1,000 darts from the Wraith ship. The Wraith ship is also over double the size of the Pegasus.
Yes, the only thing that I think the Pegasus has over over the Wraith ship, and
is raw firepower? I agree.
Is the well, yes, is the nukes. The nukes are what takes out the Wraith hive ships.
Well, however, it's not just course, the nukes, but you also have the flat cannons.
Yeah, the main guns are what's going to do it. The bow cannons on the Mercury class will be pretty damn impossible for the Wraith to sort of counter. Missiles and nukes, they can counter them all day long.
Yes, that's true. However, the Wraith ship, though, has the just nearly unlimited number of darts that would easily overpower, you know.
I strongly disagree. When you have the, and I don't mean the bow cannon, I don't mean those big guns in the front. I'm talking about the guns that line up, that are all along the back of the Mercury class. At that kind of flat shield would be so great if you, as soon as it starts that up at the carrier, the darts would come out, would be coming out into that.
Yeah,
and would end up getting torn to shreds as they're coming out. Even if there is a ton of them, you take into account also. You take the stealth ship. You take a stealth ship from the Mercury class.
Sorry, AJ, I have to stop you right there. The stealth ship was custom made, and was only stealth against radar, and that was from Galactica, not Pegasus.
It was also used on Pegasus. If you remember when
it was housed on Galactica at all times.
It was housed on Galactica. It was.
No, but when Starbuck and Apollo were moved, were transferred to the Pegasus.
It was still on Galactica. The point that you're thinking of is when Starbuck went off and did that photo run, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, it shows that I'm pretty sure it shows the Galactica Bridge, where they say, look, they want this, the Blackbird taken out to... Admiral wants the Blackbird taken out to do more tests, and she's like, but Starbuck took that thing out like an hour ago. Sort of type deal.
All right, well, even if that's the case, as the darts are getting torn to shreds coming up, you can still get a fighter in close enough, drop a nuke down its... launch bays, and boom, bye-bye.
Well,
not really. They just do what the darts do and shoot the nuke down. You can drop a nuke all day long. The darts are just going to shoot it down.
But again, like I said, if you're getting in that close...
Well, okay, yeah, but I don't think the Vipers would risk getting that close to a Wraith Hive.
Yeah, no, a Viper couldn't. It would have to be... What would have to happen, it would have to be a...
Raptor,
as they did, yes, as they used before in the show.
Yeah.
If you're a Raptor, that would have to jump in somewhere and then basically act as like debris or something. It would have to be something like that. And also, put this in perspective, we have almost a perfect analogy in the BSG universe to show that it's likely, in my opinion, that the Hive would win. Anytime you had the base stars, you had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Cylon Raiders coming at the ship, the Gladstone.
I have to stop you with the analogy really, really quickly.
Yes.
The Wraith darts, the Wraith darts are in no way comparable to the Cylon Raiders in almost every respect, with the exception of sheer numbers. I just wanted to point that out in case there's people out there going, anyway, continue.
I'm only pointing out the sheer numbers. That's all I'm pointing out. When the Galactica was under that, you know, constant stream of raiders, the only reason they ever survived those attacks is because they jumped out. The that onslaught of raiders, and most of the time they're dealing with those Vipers. The Wraith darts would just plow through them, just like they bombarded Atlantis.
Yeah.
No, but if you take into account the fact that the Wraith Hive isn't designed to go up against a sustained flak attack like that. And in the midst of all that flak, if you fire a nuke alongside the flak, any darts that are going to be in the way, I'm sorry, you know, they're not going to have a chance to be able to get inside the flak long enough and last long enough to to shoot down a nuke. And on top of
that, the same could be said for the nuke. The nuke could easily be taken out by the flak.
Yeah, I was going to say the nuke.
Not necessarily. It depends on the targeting systems and how they fire it and how they structure it. But it is within the realm of feasibility that you could structure the flak in such a way that there was a narrow enough gap in them that the flak would not hit would not hit the nuke and shoot down their own nuke.
But the problem with
shit going out there, even if you just fired it alongside the flak, with that much shit out there, the chances of them finding the nuke and being able to find it, get close enough, target it, and take it out in that space of time. Plus, keep in mind that going toe-to-toe, not just the Pegasus, but the Galactica, a far inferior ship, could still go toe-to-toe with the Cylon base star. The only reason they jump out isn't because they can't survive. It's because they have to defend the fleet. And there are multiple occasions where they show a Mercury class going toe-to-toe with multiple Cylon base stars and surviving when the Pegasus is finally destroyed, takes out two base stars with it.
Yeah, again, the biggest difference is sheer tonnage. The Pegasus is just too small. It'd be like the Wraith Hives are upwards of 4 or 5 kilometers long, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
They're absolutely ridiculous. I think the cannon size is almost the size of a Super Star Destroyer, but that's just too big. But they're 4 or 5 kilometers based on what they've shown on screen. It sounds about right. And considering they're using plasma based weapons, which the Pegasus is not designed to go up against.
Oh, certainly not. With no shields or anything. It's just.
Exactly.
It would melt through it.
Cut straight through it.
I'm sorry, but if it can handle a nuke, if the Galactica can handle multiple nukes, then the Mercury class can handle even more. And yes, plasma would be hard on it, but if it can withstand the energy and plasma of a nuke, it will withstand the energy plasma of a Hive weapon. And in addition to that, that's assuming that the Hive can even get a shot through its flat cannon. Again, though
We've seen the Hives take on Aurora class and Daedalus class, and in both scenarios, the Wraith blast made it through the counter fires.
Wraith blasts are energy, are plasma. It wouldn't get shot down.
Yeah.
As soon as it comes in contact with some of the flak, it would expel its energy. It wouldn't get shot down.
Well,
but most, if not all of it. And also keep in mind that the only reason that the Hives were able to go up against the Ashuran and the ancient ships is because of numbers. We're talking about a head-to-head right now.
Yeah.
And the only reason that the Hive ship was able to take out the Ashuran ships is because of numbers.
Well, yes,
which is not the case in this.
That is the case if you focus on, again, the darts. They don't send the darts just in one straight line that you can counter with flak. If they set them out, again, using a strategy of where the Wraith Hive is far enough away to not be affected by the cannons, which is their standard fighting procedure is to start away and then come in. If they broadside and turn side on and just barrage to high hell, which we've seen them do on multiple occasions, the darts themselves can be scattered over quite a substantial area, considering how many there are. There's almost no effective defense to that many darts. It's just, if you're going a numbers game, thousands versus 50. Even if it's thousands versus a Battlestar, you're still going to be hurting.
Well, what I'm saying is that the flak spread would be able to engulf the ship. And because of that, as the darts come out, they're going to get hit by the flak as they come out, and very few would be able to survive just emerging from the ship. Now, yes, if the Hive...
So are you going to target all, I think it's like 15 or 20 hangar bays at the same time? On both sides of the ship, including down the middle.
Both sides of the ship, that... Not even so, because you would at least get half of them.
Yeah, but all the darts would be flying at the other bays at the same time. You'd have
so even if it, out. even if
you... as they start to clear the ship, some of them are going to get caught up in the flak.
Yeah.
Not enough. I don't think so.
Yeah, I hate to say it, EJ, but I actually have to go with the evil side on this one. I could see a scenario where the Pegasus could win if it jumped in right on top of the hive, point blank range, and just fired everything. Yeah, I could see taking it out. But in a carrier style battle, which is what this is, the hive is just it's too big. It's got too many units that it can launch.
I don't know. Even so, with the amount of guns on the Galactica, which and the concentration of the defensive weapons, I have a hard time seeing the hive darts getting close enough to do any serious damage.
With that many.
Sorry, go, Michael.
I was just saying, with that many, I mean, it has very impressive flak defense, but I can't see that it being able to take on that many overwhelming number of darts.
Yeah. Well, and where do they establish that there's that many darts?
You
basically
see it
any
every
episode of the show.
Anytime you see
a lot of darts, but we're saying thousands. I mean, where's
you know what? I will look this up right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do right now. I mean, a couple hundred. I mean, yeah, it would be rough. And also, we should look up the number of fighters on a Mercury class.
I got the Wraith Hive.
Please hold while we get back to the debate. Research is being done.
Okay, so first of all, the ship is Wraith Hive is 3.9 miles long. Passengers, tens of thousands. Wraith Hives don't actually have carriers in them, right? No, they don't.
The Wraith cruisers mount officially mount one under the bow and one on each side, but you only see that in the episode The Siege. You don't see that anywhere else.
Alright, so we're not counting those?
We're not counting the cruisers, no. Counting the cruisers as independent ships, so they don't get counted as part of the Wraith Hive.
Alright. It says darts, it doesn't say how many darts. Hang on.
I still think Eva wins this one.
I agree.
No, but... because I just realized there's 80 Viper launch tubes.
Wow. Which
means there's at least 80 fighters, which is double the number, and what's probably most likely is that you launch a round and then you have the ability to launch more. Now in BSG the series, most of their fighters were taken out by the Cylon sneak attack and then by attrition afterwards until
the Pegasus did have the ability to remake them though. It had all the factory facilities inside it for that purpose.
As did Galactica.
No, Galactica didn't. Galactica had all that stuff removed. They had to rebuild it and harvest it from the civilian fleet in order to do that, and they couldn't manufacture fighters.
The entire arc where they figured out how to build it, and that's what the stealth ship became.
Yeah, one ship.
They built one ship instead of
That was the proof of concept. And then later on, they talk about the episode with Scar, where Galactica has to sit there and guard a mining detail so they can get the resources to continue building Vipers.
But those Vipers were being built not on Galactica but on Pegasus.
They specifically say construction teams on Pegasus and Galactica.
Okay.
And the construction facilities on Pegasus is more of an outgrowth of, Galactica figured out how to build ships on the carrier, so let's go ahead and have both carriers do that. That's more what that was about. Also, you have... you have the Raptors. So the Raptors can B-debris launch nukes. You have a lot more fighters than we initially thought on the Galactic or on the Pegasus, a Mercury class. Two flight pods, four flight decks, 80 Viper launch tubes, which would indicate to me that there's at least two, possibly more, rounds of fighters.
Yeah. I'd have to agree that we have totally forgotten the Raptors.
Right. So if you have the Raptors doing hit and run attacks or kind of acting as debris, launching as nukes when need be, or just providing general support, you take that into account with the fact that if you have these, you know, let's say 150 to 200 Vipers surrounding one side of the ship. Let's say there's 1,000 Vipers on the other one. You have the flak from the Pegasus engulfing one side of the ship. So any darts coming out of there, gone. You have the fighters or the Vipers taking care of ones coming out the other end. So immediately you're only dealing with 2-on-1 odds. Considering how adept of a fighter and how agile of a fighter the dart is, the Viper, even the Mark II Vipers are going to have an advantage going ship to ship. And
fighter versus fighter, there's no contest. The dart is going to get its ass kicked.
Exactly.
If A302 can rinse dozens of the things, the Viper can do even more than that.
Precisely. Oh yeah, Vipers are incredibly maneuverable too.
Yeah.
So you're going about. You're going about 160 on 200 with a superior fighter, plus if you have a wing of Raptors all launching nukes at the same time, I'm sorry, but at least one of those is going to get through. And even if it doesn't directly hit the hive ship, you can still set them to detonate amidst the fighters as they're coming out.
Yeah.
It's the darts as they're coming out. So even with the numbers, there is a strategy where you could effectively beat the hive ship, considering the greater quality of the Mercury class versus the greater numbers.
Don't forget, the Mercury class is technically a warship, whereas the Wraith Hive is technically a colony ship. It's not necessarily a warship per se.
True.
Sort of the warship role of the Mercury of the.
A lot more of a beating.
Yeah,
I would say at best maybe it'd be a tie.
Yeah. I'll see the tie.
The only thing I was able to find about the complement of darts is that there's one article where it says that the hive ship carried hundreds of darts, but as far as I was aware, I thought it was thousands.
All right, so even so that even makes it greater.
Yes, it makes for the Mercury class.
So let's say there's 300 darts. You're 2-1. Half of your ship is already unable to launch fighters. Yes, you have the plasma, but I really doubt the plasma would be able to make it through all that. And they don't have nukes. And the Galactica the Pegasus would have enough nukes to be able to, even if a few of them were shot down, you still have at least one would make it through.
How many guns does the Wraith Hive ship have?
I don't know how many, but I do know
I remember seeing ton. I remember just firing off one after another at the Daedalus class.
Yeah, it could. The Wraith Hive itself doesn't technically have that many guns, but they're buried inside the hull, so they're very hard to target specifically. And they can rapid fire. They can fire multiple shots fairly quickly.
True, but it doesn't have what I'm looking at doesn't even mention the amount of guns. But it doesn't have the ability to concentrate the fire the way a Mercury class can.
Yeah.
Even if it does have the ability to rapid fire, its version of rapid fire is like fire, fire. Fire, whereas you have a twin cannon design on each of the cannons of the flak shield, and it's going bam, 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 as opposed to bam, bam.
Actually, I th- bam. Based on what we saw in the series, the heavy cannons on Pegasus could fire once every 3 or 4 seconds, with the smaller side-mounted cannons firing about the same rate. The small cannons, the anti-fighter flak screen, they could fire a hell of a lot faster.
And that's what I'm
whereas
I'm
the
not
rate...
even taking into account. I'm not even taking into account the main cannons along the front. I'm taking it because, and the reason for that is the flak shield on the side, the broadside flak shield is going to, and that is going to be a lot more effective against a carrier, another carrier, than the main cannons. Because as soon as it has to turn and use its main cannons on the hive, you lose that flak shield and the one strategic advantage you have over the race's superior numbers.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm not going into that. But let's say it kept up the flak shield and the Viper and the Vipers were able to wrap up the, let's say, 300 darts. Then yeah, the Pegasus can turn and start firing and launching nukes and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, we have one more ship left.
Yeah, luckily for us, this one last ship. See, I'm gonna fuck it. I'll just because I'm too lazy, I'm gonna call that one a tie.
What?
Tie.
I don't agree. I think. I am sorry. I have to say. I have to say. I think the Aurora would kick its ass.
Oh no! I'll take the carrier.
Oh, the carrier. Carriers. It's a tie.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, I agree. A tie.
Okay.
So your class wins, but okay.
Yeah. The next one is another one of those sort of straightforward wins.
So this one is another one of those straightforward wins.
So EJ, you get to defend the Superstar Destroyer. Michael, you get to defend the Aurora.
Yes.
Oh.
So.
Hear your argument.
So this could prove hilarious.
Use them to use up the Aurora's stash of drones, and then it's pretty much defenseless. The Star Destroyer comes in and mops it up with its turbo lasers. It's a very cost effective, and the very costly to the fighter squadrons, but yeah, that's how you do it.
Or if you're the Aurora class, you just ignore the fighters because you've got shields that don't allow fighters to go through, therefore they're not a threat to you, and just fire everything at the bridge and watch the Superstar Destroyer turn off. And more than likely crash into the starbase because apparently they're magnetically attracted to each other.
Oh, or alternatively, you pull a Ender's Game, use the fighters as a flag shield so that the drones can't physically get to the ship, and basically
EJ,
have them
kamikaze.
And
I've
then,
got the
huh?
I've got your ship the fighter compliments. It's not even close to enough to wear out the Aurora. Sorry.
Yeah. Aurora's got way too many drones.
Yeah, you have TIE/LN Starfighter, TIE Starfighters 48, TIE Bombers 12, TIE Boarding Craft 12, Lambda class shuttles 8, Delta class Stormtrooper transports 15, Assault Gunboats 5. You do not
those are squadrons, not actual counts.
Either way, it's nowhere near enough.
It's nowhere near enough.
Oh, I don't know. If those are squadrons.
Yeah, I said that.
The squadrons are 4.
Between 4 and 8, depending on the unit.
Well, yeah, that's true. But it's still not enough.
Work it out.
So.
Back to that one news.
Ram the son of a bitch.
Well, the Aurora.
So what you're saying is the Superstar Destroyer is floating there out of nowhere. Warp beams onto the bridge and goes, "So perhaps today is a good day to die." Ramming speed, and just charges at it. And the Aurora's just like, "What the hell are these idiots doing? Fire everything!"
Yeah, I'm sorry. I am pretty sure that the Aurora.
Nero's captaining the Aurora. Apparently, fire everything.
The trap.
Now, if the capital ship, if the executor SSD hits hyperdrive and aims it in such a way that it basically blasts into the Aurora, the speed and mass would be sufficient to take it out, and it would be fast enough to prevent
drones
to be able to take it out. And even if the drones did take it out, once the course was set, I don't care how powerful the drones are, the sheer momentum of the ship would slam into it. So
yeah, don't forget, the Aurora-class ship with shields, this is a substantially damaged Aurora-class ship, mind you, with shields with almost no power in them, survived a super volcano eruption at point-blanking range.
Yeah,
not for a very long period of time, but long enough.
There's a big difference between a volcano and, let's see.
This thing was literally parked in the middle of Yellowstone National Park when it exploded.
Well, that's not actually literally.
Underground, covered in lava.
It was, and I'm sorry.
Yeah, so it's not literally Yellowstone National Park, but it's the equivalent of Yellowstone National Park.
The Super Star Destroyer's weapons just, they're not, terminal lasers are nothing compared to that.
Which is why I'm advocating a,
screw you, we're all gonna die. Screw you, we're all gonna die sort of strategy.
Aurora class ship has enough maneuverability to get out of there.
Yeah.
Not necessarily.
Yeah, sorry, EJ. I flipped it so that I would get a chance to say this once tonight. You lose.
Suicide run.
So.
No.
Okay.
Suicide run. Now the question is, how would these all function together?
As a fleet.
Now, as a fleet, if you had the Ori rain ship go up against the Aurora capital ship. And then you had the cruiser, the Star Destroyers, both Star Destroyers function as frigates and anti-fire frigates.
Yeah.
Then, which is the roles these things would really play based on their strengths. And if you keep the Death Star at a far enough distance, honestly, the Death Star is going to be your main ranged weapon here. You keep that at a distance, and it could just pick off the capital ships while everyone else goes at the smaller ships.
The Death Star, though, isn't effective at picking up, is just so ineffective at targeting its main weapon. It has to be targeted at one thing, the stationary thing that will not move out of range during the time it takes for the weapon to power and fire, which, as we saw in the movie, took easily more than enough time for something to move out of its range.
It can also only target objects of a
Return of the Jedi, in a massive fleet action where you don't necessarily, you know, where you're not necessarily going to see everything coming or know you're being targeted, and if it focuses on the bigger, less maneuverable ships, which are going to be the most dangerous on the good side, Galaxy class up is fried.
Yeah, Galaxy class,
Galaxy class. Galaxy class is pretty maneuverable, especially with separation.
The Pegasus, the Mercury class, Battlestar, I agree. It would be toast.
Oh, yes.
You're going to have a bad day. The Aurora would be hurting. It's okay, Amy. We've got enough time left, I think. We've got enough time.
The Ori ship goes up against the Galaxy class.
So, put it this way. If for the evil guys to win, the evil guys could win.
They've lost.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Healing simple.
Yeah. No. In a fleet action as a combined unit, the bad guys could win depending on the strategy, but the good guys could win depending on the strategy. If we look at a ship versus ship.
Guys would never cooperate.
Well, we're functioning in a universe where.
Okay. You've got five people on the bad guy ship that will pretty much either try to fight over the computer or eat everyone.
Yeah, we're not talking about the hero ship. We're talking about the fleet in general.
Yeah.
I know what you mean. Like the hero command ship. The enemy command ship is just hilarious. I would love to watch that as an episode of a show. Just all those different bad guys mushed together would be great. Would be great, great comedy. But overall,
I have to say though, Evil has a much better engineer. I love Kaylee. I love Kaylee, but she's never done anything more than a transport ship.
Yeah, and she's in that transport ship. She's effectively MacGyver.
True, but she would have to A, know how to run teams of people, which she doesn't, in order to do something on a bigger scale, like a galaxy class. And she would have to have a great much greater breadth of knowledge in order to function on anything other than a transport. And she just doesn't have that.
Can I ask how in the world Davros became chief medical officer? I did not notice this. How the heck did that happen?
I honestly don't have an answer. I really don't. There's a lot of the votes on the enemy side where I'm looking at it going, what the fuck are you people thinking?
I mean, I can see most of them. I just don't get Davros as chief medical officer. It makes absolutely no sense.
It makes sense in that he's a medical genius that
created an entire race.
It doesn't make sense the fact that he would say, oh, you're injured, good, die so that my Daleks can take over the universe.
Yeah.
You are an inferior life form and you must die.
No, but one thing I actually seriously wanted to see what you guys thought. What do you think, because we never actually saw, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think we ever actually saw an outright confrontation, any kind of confrontation between an Ori ship and a Sorin or ancient Aurora class.
There was no direct conflict between the two.
What do you think happened? Because that would be, because they're both on the same level of technology. They're all ancients. They're just the Ori split off. Who do you think would win?
They've also got a different weapon strategy. The ancients use projectile-based weapons, like the drones, primarily. Whereas the Ori use energy-based weapons, primarily. The ancient shields were probably on par, because we see the Asgard beam weapons being just as effective against the Aurora class as Ori class.
Yeah.
So that's the only cross comparison we have is the Mark II 304 and which was most effective against it. Now the Daedalus class, the specifically the Odyssey, took two hits from the main cannon. One hit from the main Ori cannon crippled it. The Korolev, which was a fairly new ship, and the argument could be made it wasn't up to spec because of that it wasn't finished, took three to be taken out. Now, the only example we have of a 304 being taken out by a Wraith ship was when it was outnumbered dozens to one. And those Wraith ships need to outnumber the Aurora class dozens to one in order to win.
Yeah.
And we don't really see a Mark One, a Mark One Daedalus take on any Aurora level ships, but it is implied that they're stronger. And the Mark Twos go up against the Aurora classes in the Siege of Asuras, and just cut them to ribbons.
Now, I would make the argument, though, that the Aurora and Ori ships are not on the same level, because what we're seeing with the Aurora ships is the final level of technology that was reached before they ascended to a higher plane of existence. However, what we're seeing with the Ori ships are the level of technology that the Ori are willing to give their followers just enough to take on anything in the Milky Way galaxy. It's not necessarily going to be the same level as the Asurans, who are, again, the final level possible before evolving to a higher plane of existence.
And you've got to remember that you've also got to remember that the Ori motherships were built by relatively low technology level people, so there's only so much advanced level tech that can be
My evidence for the Ori ships not being as powerful as the Asuran ships is because the Asgard weapons were able to take them out pretty effectively. And when you consider the fact that the Asgard have themselves admitted to not knowing a fraction of what the ancients knew before they ascended.
Yeah, that's a fair point. So,
yeah, okay.
Anyway, we've got about 5 minutes left, so we're going to go to the news. Since there's only really one news article of worthy of mention this week, and that actually happened only a little while ago. You found a few others?
Well, I found one about Men in Black reboot.
Oh, yeah, they're doing a Men in Black reboot. Boo!
Without Will Smith.
Reboot?
They're rebooting Men in Black without Will Smith.
A reboot?
Is it a reboot or is it a sequel without Will Smith?
The article isn't very specific.
Better not be a fracking reboot.
Oh, if it... boo. Boo.
If it's a sequel, I'm fine with it. If it's a reboot, I'm boycotting it, just like I'm boycotting the all-female Ghostbusters.
Yeah. Anyway, but the big news was actually last night. And I just want to comment on the mainstream media blowing this out of fucking proportion, like always. Oh, NASA's going to make an announcement. They've found life on Mars. No.
They found water.
No.
Liquid.
They found something far more important. Liquid water.
Who said that there was going to be life?
Oh, every other news article you looked at. Well, as soon as NASA made the announcement... they're all over the place over here.
I saw some of them. It's like, is there life on Mars? I don't know.
Oh,
you know, there's this NASA announcement. And really what it was is it's like, okay, there's a greater likelihood that there could be life on Mars because now we've found even more evidence that there is liquid water on Mars, possibly from a large underground aquifer.
Yeah, and
now,
it's...
that is still huge news, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It's very, very briny water, so it's not necessarily something you want to drink.
We'd have to bring some kind of desalination technology.
Yeah.
But I bet you that the salt in there is probably not too far off from what our primordial oceans were.
Yeah. And as EJ quipped during our little break in the middle, Mars is effectively one giant salt lick, if you think about it.
I didn't quip that.
I don't see that at all.
Yeah, you all suck. You're boring. So anyway, oh god damn it. Okay, final tallies are Starbase, hero wins, scout, hero, fighter, hero, short, bomber, hero, dropship was a tie, corvette was a tie, frigate was evil.
No,
sorry, frigate was good, destroyer was evil, range ship was good. Cruiser was a no contest, good. The carrier was a tie.
How did the hell did the Vorcha beat? You know what? We're not discussing this right now. I'm not.
We don't.
Cloaking device gets in too close for nukes or the Asgard weapons.
Yeah, pretty much. See, that's Michael's fault for missing the first half. Him and his Taekwondo. And the final one was the good guys won the capital ship. So that is the end results of all of that.
Can I point out that the only one I lost was the one that was designed for me to lose?
No.
No. This is why I keep David around. No, this is why I'm a fan. You are amazing.
I don't like you anymore. You're a meanie.
Come on. I haven't said much because I don't have much opinion on most of them.
Yeah. So, is there any other news, Amy? You've got about a minute left.
No, there's no real news.
Well, that's boring.
No, but get Kamikaze. We're going to premiere Be There or Be Square.
Yes, I was going to say tonight's episode of the podcast was brought to you by Inner Dimension, which is now on YouTube. So, jump on over. Tell them we send them the love. They've got episode 1 and 2 up, and episode 3 is going to be up fairly soon. So, Kasha, we love you, and we'll catch you in the next one.
Bye, all.
Bye, guys.
Live long and prosper.
So long, and thanks for all the fish. Do 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 do. I don't actually know the rest of the words. I'm just gonna keep doing the tune until we run out of time.
How much time do we need to run out of? We've done this for 2 hours. 2.5 hours, actually.
Oh, that was a fun one, though. Even. Oh, that was a fun one, though. Even. Oh, that was a fun one, though. Even. Oh, that was a fun.